The mob tried to kill him once. He survived. And ever after that was called Lucky. He became the godfather of the modern crime syndicate. Charles Lucky Luciano climbed the mob ladder. He organized organized crime. He became an equal opportunity mob boss. But his creation of a murder-for-hire ring made him one of the deadliest.
In the early 1930s, New York was a mob killing field. Out of this bloody chaos, there emerged one cold-hearted, brilliant gangster named Lucky Luciano.
You never looked in his eyes, because it was strange, it was haunting, weird.
Lucky connived and killed his way to the top. When he got there, he laid the foundation of modern organized crime, and the money poured in.
He loved being Charlie Lucky Luciano, the number one gangster in town.
Luciano thrived on his reputation as the biggest racketeer and the most eligible bachelor in Manhattan.
Every time he would walk into a room, I'd get like butterflies in my stomach. It was like a sexual attraction.
But Lucky paid the price for his notoriety when a crusading gangbuster named Thomas E. Dewey sent him off to prison. Behind bars, Lucky not only kept his position as chairman of the mob, but came to the aid of his beloved United States during World War II, greasing the way for U.S. troops invading his native Sicily. After the war, the gangster who loved America was forced to leave it behind. But Lucky would then prove that the mob, like other big businesses, was not troubled by national borders. Lucky could run a racket anywhere, and did. The man who would one day make the mob run like a big business was born in the poor Sicilian town of Lercara Fridi on November 24th, 1897, and given the name Salvatore Lucania. It was a town where most of the men, including his father, worked long days in the sulfur mine at the top of the hill. A hard life from which the family longed to escape. Hearing that across the ocean, America had streets paved with gold, they sailed to the promised land in 1907. The family found a flat in a Jewish neighborhood on the Lower East Side of Manhattan, just a few blocks from relatives in Little Italy. Only the streets were not as promised. Housing was cramped and dirty. Crime was rampant. Young Salvatore, one of four children, enrolled at PS 40, but he rarely showed up at school. Soon, he was dumped into the Brooklyn Truant School. By age 14, he was a dropout. His first job, delivery boy for a hat maker, earned him $7 a week. Chump change to many of the young hoods that Charlie encountered on the streets. Their racket, shaking down immigrants who sold food and clothing from pushcarts. Salvatore also saw kids his own age, gambling, fencing stolen goods, and dealing drugs. The streets were soon his classroom of crime. He was an eager and clever student.
There was always a suspicion that he used that job of delivering hats when he first started fooling around with the sale of illegal drugs, and that he would put some in the hat boxes as a good hiding place and stroll along. There'd be nothing in his pockets incriminating. When he wanted to make a delivery, just reach into the hat box, make the sale, and continue on his way.
He heard the lure of the street at a very early age, at least by the age of 14. He, by then, had committed to a criminal life. He was out there doing small-time crimes, smoking opium, having a sex life of sorts.
New York City police caught up with him for the first time at the age of 18. The charge? Possession of heroin. By then, he was using various names, including Charles Lucky Luciano. But for the moment, his luck had run out. He got a year in prison. Luciano's hardworking parents, embarrassed by their drug-dealing son, never visited him in prison. After 6 months behind bars, Charlie was released, having used the time to further his criminal education. Besides peddling dope, he now gambled, earned much more money, carried a gun, and joined his first Italian gang, the Five Pointers. The gang was well-connected. Every election day, its job was to harass voters, sometimes at gunpoint, into supporting New York's corrupt Democratic machine known as Tammany Hall. For this, the gang was well compensated.
That would enable them to engage in their other criminal activities during the year with a very understanding Tammany Hall, who appointed the police captain in each precinct, who appointed the magistrate that you would be brought before if you should be arrested. So you got protection for all of your illegal activities during the course of the year if you worked for Tammany Hall on election day.
But Tammany Hall couldn't always protect the gang. In 1923, federal narcotics agents arrested Luciano for dealing heroin. Charlie decided to save himself by ratting on some Jewish gangsters who had a trunk full of heroin in a basement on the Lower East Side. It was nothing personal against Jewish crooks. In fact, Charlie, who had grown up in a Jewish neighborhood, was unique in his early willingness to work with gangsters of any background.
And if they could get along together and make money together, that was the only standard that Luciano had. He didn't care what your nationality was or what your religion was. If I can trust you and we can make money, we'll work together.
Two of the Jewish gangsters he befriended were the good-looking, violent Benjamin Bugsy Siegel and the short, quiet, intellectual Meyer Lansky, who would become Luciano's most loyal partner in crime for the next half a century.
And they got together on the Lower East Side, sometime in their late teens, apparently, and became very close friends. A relationship that was so close that Bugsy Siegel, for example, who knew them both well, said that they were more than brothers, they were almost like lovers. Not to suggest that they had sex, but they had that kind of unspoken, intuitive bond. They could finish each other's sentences, or there would be a pause, and then the other one would say what the other was thinking. It was a very close connection. And it's a key to Luciano's rise, because he always has Lansky whispering in his ear.
Another key to the rise of Charles Luciano? Being in the right place, New York, at the right time, the 1920s, the era of prohibition and bootlegging. Charlie and his friends were lucky enough to learn the racket at the feet of a master, Arnold Rothstein, the man reputed to have fixed the 1919 World Series.
Arnold Rothstein hired Lansky, Ann Luciano, Ben Siegel, Frank Costello, a lot of other people who became famous names in organized crime later on, all went to work originally for Rothstein. He became a financial backer for some of these young men. Okay, you learn the business, now you go out on your own, and I will give you the financial backing and some political protection.
Just like Al Capone out in Chicago, Charlie Luciano would earn his first million as a bootlegger. But unlike Capone, who was happy to consolidate organized crime in one city, Luciano would have a grander and darker vision. A board of directors overseeing rackets around the country, with himself as chairman of the board. Mob warfare has been known to create new crime bosses. Through cunning and violence, ambitious gangsters mold the chaos of war into a peace which they alone control. The rise to power of Lucky Luciano was the classic example. By the late 1920s, young Luciano was entering his 30s and already a big player in the New York mob. He was one of a few Italians who had valuable connections to Jewish gangsters such as Meyer Lansky and Bugsy Siegel. It wasn't long before one of the reigning Sicilian dons, Joe the Boss Masseria, embraced Luciano and made him his right-hand man. Lucky had the perfect qualifications for the job: power, connections, and most importantly, Sicilian ancestry.
He was of Sicilian birth, Sicilian on both sides of his family, and you needed that in those days to make anywhere in the mafia. But at the same time, he was more Americanized. He also had much wider contacts than most of the Sicilian gangsters, so he was able to use both these things to rise as a gangster.
He also used the bloody turf war that was raging between Joe the Boss Masseria and another old-time Sicilian don, Salvatore Maranzano. First, Maranzano tried to persuade Lucky to switch sides and work for him. When Luciano refused, he paid a stiff price.
He was picked up by four gangsters, apparently, around 50th Street in New York City. They beat him up terribly. He was bloodied and stabbed and kicked around and left for dead.
Luciano's survival was a stroke of luck, reaffirming the nickname he'd used for years. The attack by Maranzano's men left him with a droopy eyelid and a nasty scar across the chin, which did nothing to improve his already harsh features.
He was pockmarked anyway from smallpox when he was a child. So you looked at him for the first time and it was a nightmare of a face, I can tell you.
The attack left another deep and lasting impression on Luciano. that the gang war between the two aging Sicilians was pointless and bad for business. And it was his mission to resolve it on his terms. Step one.
He took his boss to lunch at a very nice Italian restaurant in Coney Island.
At a certain point, Luciano excuses himself and goes to the men's room. And just at that point, remarkably enough, in come the assassins and kill Joe the boss. So Luciano has shifted his allegiance to Joe the boss's great rival, Salvatore Maranzano.
Predictably, Maranzano embraced Lucky and made him his right-hand man. But Luciano had no patience for his new boss with his old-world traditions.
The old school of Sicilian mafia bosses was very formal and had strict codes of behavior and strict forms of even social forms of address and initiation into the mafia. Luciano wasn't interested in any of that stuff. Bucks is what we're after.
So step two, kill the new boss. Lucky hired his Jewish friends, including Bugsy Siegel, to be the hitmen. They cornered Maranzano in his office near Grand Central Station.
They opened fire on him and they stabbed him with knives. They just made mincemeat out of him, just blew him away.
Having killed the two leading dons in New York, Luciano was now unquestionably the most dominant single gangster in the biggest mob city in America. So Lucky set about Americanizing the mafia. He gathered around him the heads of the major crime families in New York City, Chicago, and Buffalo, and made them into a board of directors. He called it the Commission. To avoid turf battles and maximize profits, they divvied up the rackets. With the end of Prohibition in 1933, the big rackets were gambling, prostitution, narcotics, and extortion. They also created their own group of contract killers, known in the press as Murder Incorporated. The chairman of this commission was Luciano himself. Lucky's organizing paid off. Gangsters started killing each other far less often and making much more money.
Organized crime families were pulling in as much money as the 10 largest industrial corporations in the United States put together.
Luciano's success as chairman of the mob was due to a basic leadership skill. He knew how to listen and get others to listen to him.
When Lucky told a story, when Lucky said anything at all, everybody listened, yeah, Lucky laughed, everybody laughed. It was just wonderful to watch this. But when he got mad, it's like a knife right at you.
Off the job, Lucky, the confirmed bachelor, enjoyed life as any social climbing multimillionaire would in the midst of the Great Depression.
He lived a very glamorous life, the best nightclubs, the Stork Club, the 21 restaurant, the races. He got around to all the right places, always with a big wad of cash.
He prided himself on the elegance of his clothes. He always had a great, huge white handkerchief just exploding out of his pocket.
In the early 1930s, former President Herbert Hoover kept a New York apartment in the Waldorf Towers. General Douglas MacArthur had an apartment in the Waldorf Towers. And Lucky Luciano moved into the Waldorf Towers. That impressed a great many people.
Especially women. Lots of them. What Luciano lacked in the looks department, he made up for in charm and the eternal twin aphrodisiacs, money and power.
I used to get a funny feeling whenever Lucky would walk in a room, and when I was real young, I never could understand that. I didn't realize that's how dopey I was. I didn't realize that it was like a sexual attraction.
He has parties, there are lots of women around, but never any serious relationship. I think it says something about his ultimate selfishness and self-involvement. What he was interested in was his career as the biggest gangster in town, and he didn't want any distractions. He wanted women for momentary amusement, but for nothing more than that.
Luciano was a regular on the Manhattan social scene. The upper crust didn't mind that during business hours, Lucky was a cold-blooded killer, extorting millions.
A lot of white Anglo-Saxon Protestant blue buds used to love to go downtown and see a real-life gangster and probably fawn and I wouldn't have been surprised if they had asked for his autograph. That's the kind of figure he had become. The newspaper people. You got to remember that New York City had 9 newspapers in that era. All the newsmen knew him, and it was a wave and a hello and hi, you're lucky, and so on.
It was very dangerous. Blansky always said, they'll nail you for this. This is inviting trouble that you don't need. But he loved being Charlie Lucky Luciano, the number one gangster in town. And he liked to be seen and celebrated. He was always beautifully dressed, expensive cars and jewelry, expensive women, expensive places. He liked that high life and didn't want any intrusion on it.
But in 1935, one man would intrude on it and take away all the luxuries to which Lucky Luciano had become accustomed. His name? Thomas E. Dewey. Just as Lucky Luciano's rise to power was a classic tale of mob intrigue, his demise was one of the most celebrated examples of the crusade against organized crime. The crusader was someone with just as much ambition and cunning as Luciano himself. Thomas E. Dewey, appointed in 1935 as special prosecutor in Manhattan. Dewey established his anti-mob headquarters on the 14th floor of the Woolworth Building. His newsreels addressed the public's growing disenchantment with mob corruption.
The real problem is to remove the influence of the racketeer from politics. Local authorities in New York and in almost every great city in the country hold office by grace of politicians who are in partnership with criminals.
He was honest. He was forthright. Time meant nothing to him, and his word meant everything to him. He could be trusted, and he was trusted.
One of Dewey's first targets, a powerful Jewish racketeer in the Bronx, and a founding member of Luciano's commission named Dutch Schultz. The word on the street was that Schultz was planning to kill Dewey. But mob boss Lucky Luciano and the rest of the commission members knew that killing Dewey would only bring more heat on the underworld. So in October 1935, Lucky did the prudent thing. He ordered the killing of Dutch Schultz, seen here examining his bullet wounds moments before he died. After the murder of Schultz, Prosecutor Dewey did not let up. Instead, he turned his fierce gang-busting crusade against the top racketeer in America, Lucky Luciano. Ironically, the racket Dewey nailed Luciano for was not Murder, Inc., or gambling, or extortion, but something to which Lucky paid very little attention, prostitution. One of Luciano's associates, a gangster named Little Davy Batillo, ran the prostitution racket. He and his henchmen extorted money from whores and pimps all over the city in return for providing them with protection.
And so to get the prostitution people to do what he wanted them to do, Batillo would say, well, Lucky's in on this too.
Now, the way things operate in their real world, if Charlie Luciano has given you the authority to operate what is now becoming a very, very lucrative business, you'd be very foolish to say, well, good, and all the money and the profit belongs to me. You'd be crazy to do that. What you should do is once a month you call up Charlie and say, Charlie, in appreciation for all you've done for me, this is for you. And when Charlie accepts that envelope full of cash, he is obtaining the fruits of prostitution.
Dewey and his team found chambermaids at the Waldorf-Astoria who were willing to testify that they had seen Davy Batillo's gangsters showing up regularly to visit Luciano in his suite. With that evidence from the Waldorf, as well as the testimony of prostitutes who'd been shaken down, Dewey had his case. By March 1936, New York was ready to put Luciano on trial. Lucky was not exactly waiting around for the cops to show up with handcuffs. He fled to the Arlington Hotel in a town well known as a mob safe haven, Hot Springs, Arkansas. Dewey sent his men after him. On April Fool's Day, 1936, Lucky was extradited from Arkansas to New York. When he stood trial in June 1936, it took the jury less than 24 hours to find him guilty of overseeing a prostitution racket. His sentence, 30 to 50 years.
It was a bombshell. It had tremendous impact politically, socially, and economically on organized crime and on the people of the city of New York.
If Lucky Luciano, the most powerful racketeer of them all, could be sent off to prison and labeled the king of the pimps, then maybe the mob was not invincible after all. Luciano's partners in crime got that message loud and clear. Meyer Lansky skipped town, relocating to Florida and Havana, where he could oversee the mob's gambling interests. Bugsy Siegel chose Hollywood, where he could expand rackets on the West Coast. But life in Dannemora prison wasn't all that bad for Luciano, who, despite his conviction, was still chairman of the mob.
He continued to run his affairs while in Dannemora. If your business is important enough, you're going to have henchmen who will come up and see you, and they'll speak in the code language.
Luciano spends his time playing gin rummy, hanging around the yard. Little Davy Patillo is in jail with him and does all his cooking for him, prepares his meals for him. Someone else does Luciano's jobs at the prison. He gets his pants pressed and his shirts pressed. And it's just a sign of his underworld reputation.
Fellow convicts weren't the only ones who still respected the power of Charles Luciano. In 1942, U.S. Naval Intelligence in New York City approached Lucky for help. A disastrous fire had recently destroyed the French luxury liner, Normandy, which was being converted into a U.S. troop carrier. It sank in the Hudson River. Naval Intelligence had spotted German submarines off the coast of New York. There were rumors of sabotage along the docks. Docks controlled by Lucky Luciano and the New York mob. Then the local naval intelligence commander, Charles Heffnenden, had a most unusual idea. Why not ask the mob for help in protecting the waterfront from the enemy?
It was kind of novel. I think his superiors responded to it, gee, we can have the mob protecting the country. Isn't that wonderful?
So the Navy first approached Lucky's best friend and fellow mobster, Meyer Lansky. Lansky then presented the idea to the boss in prison.
Luciano did not go along with it at first. My inference is that Luciano was still mad at the law, with reason. Lansky talked him into it, said it would be a good thing for the mob to be seen in this patriotic role. And so Luciano gave his permission.
Lucky was moved from the desolation of Dannemora to a place where the chairman of the mob would be much more comfortable, a minimum security prison a few hours from the city, Great Meadow.
Your classic country club type prison. And there he could talk to his underbosses and all his men freely.
It would seem that Lucky kept his word to the Navy. The docks were free of sabotage for the rest of the war. But Lucky Luciano was not done serving his country. As American and British troops were invading Sicily in July 1943, Allied intelligence had an ace in the hole named Luciano.
All the mafia bosses had been alerted by Lucky Luciano that they should be friendly to the Allied forces, to the British and Americans, and should help to facilitate the landings in every way possible, which they apparently did.
The invasion was not only a success for the Allies, but a boon for the local mafia bosses who had followed the instructions sent by Lucky Luciano from prison in New York.
The American generals and captains were so grateful to the cooperation the mafia gave them that they appointed them mayors of cities, mayors of towns. And so after the landing was successful and Italy was reconquered for the Allies, the mafia was left in a position much more powerful than it had ever been before.
When the war ended, Luciano appealed for leniency. After all, the mob boss had secretly served his country. The government agreed to his release.
And strangely enough, the same gentleman who prosecuted him, Thomas Dewey, is now the governor of the state of New York, who would have to sign the papers to release him from jail.
But Lucky would not be allowed to stay in his beloved America. He was deported back to Italy. Under the terms of his release, he would be placed under the surveillance of the Italian police and never allowed to return to the U.S. On February 10, 1946, Luciano sailed out of New York Harbor. To ease the pain, Lucky's old friends in the mob had given him a sweet going-away present.
All the bosses contributed some money to a big, fat envelope of cash. Just before the ship got underway, they handed him this gigantic envelope. which had about $300,000 or $400,000 in it. He felt very good about that.
Officially, Luciano was forbidden to leave Italy, but 10 years in prison had not dulled his sense of cunning. Lucky would not only evade Italian authorities, but establish a new power base for himself in his native land. In late February 1946, after spending 10 years in prison, the deported king of the underworld, Lucky Luciano, arrived in Naples by boat and set foot on Italian soil for the first time since childhood. Waiting for him at the dock were the Italian police, who questioned him briefly, then set him free. Even if it meant defying the terms of his deportation, which forbade him to leave Italy, Luciano was determined to rejoin his fellow gangsters and to resume the only career he knew, that of a racketeer. After only 8 months, Lucky fled to Cuba, a mafia paradise.
It was a totally corrupt society run by a dictator who was taking money and bribes from American gangsters to run the casinos there. So it was seen as an open town, Havana, for the mob, so Luciano probably thought he'd be safe there.
Safe enough to call a summit meeting in April 1947 of all his mob associates, both from New York and around the country. It was a huge gathering, including, among others, Meyer Lansky, Albert Anastasia, Carlo Gambino, and Frank Costello. Among the crowd of celebrated gangsters was a real-life celebrity named Frank Sinatra.
The excuse for the meeting was to celebrate Frank Sinatra and listen to his songs, but he was just a front. And during that meeting, they laid down a law on such things as the heroin route from Sicily to Cuba, then from Cuba to the mainland of the United States. And Luciano was the chairman of the board at that meeting.
Other issues on Lucky's agenda? The division of profits from Cuban casinos and what to do about his childhood friend, Bugsy Siegel. Bugsy had been careless with mob money and had lost millions of dollars building the Flamingo Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas.
There was a great deal of disappointment in how Ben Siegel had operated that business out there. He had been warned, again, and he's not responding. We have to do something.
Lucky made a ruthless decision. It was time to teach Bugsy the ultimate lesson in mob business, that money is more important than friendship.
They sort of held a kangaroo court there and decided, what are they going to do about Bugsy? And Lucky said, you got to kill him. That sealed Bugsy Siegel's fate.
On the evening of June 20th, 1947, in the Beverly Hills mansion of Bugsy's girlfriend, Virginia Hill, Bugsy was brutally murdered. After the summit meeting, Lucky wanted to stay put in Cuba and run the international heroin racket from there. He got along just fine with the corrupt government, including the dictator Batista. But a certain nosy agent from the U.S. Bureau of Narcotics named Harry Anslinger got in Lucky's way and pressured the Cubans to kick the gangster out.
He said that Luciano was going to be using Havana as a pumping station for illegal heroin into the United States.
Luciano thereafter calls Anslinger Ass Slinger and sees him as his nemesis and worries about him. And I think that's quite revealing. I mean, the reason Luciano was worried about Harry Anslinger, Ass Slinger, and the Bureau of Narcotics was that Luciano actually was involved in heroin trafficking and was worried that the Bureau was going to nail him for it.
Luciano was expelled from Cuba on the Turkish steamer Bakir and forced back to Italy. When the ship docked in Genoa, Italian police put Lucky in prison for a few days for violating his agreement not to leave the country. Then the authorities sent him off to Palermo in his native Sicily and put him under permanent police surveillance. The police told Luciano to stay out of trouble and keep a low profile. Anything Lucky did aroused suspicion. In a quaint Palermo square, he set up a candy factory that specialized in making what Italians call confetti, sugar-coated almonds served at weddings.
He hired some trucks to take the shipment down to a freighter, very proud of himself. But the police were there in force, and they opened up all the boxes of confetti, and they smashed with hammers all the almonds. Looking for heroin, they didn't find one drop of heroin, one speck of it, and they completely ruined this whole confetti operation.
But in fact, the authorities had every right to be suspicious of Luciano. Once, in an elegant Palermo hotel, Lucky staged a fake charity auction of dolls. Inside the dolls was heroin. Certain people who attended the auction were apparently in on the scam and helped Luciano smuggle the drugs out of town.
When we met, he obviously realized that I had no idea about those dolls, and he labeled me a classic fool. He said, "You are a moron," and he took pleasure in calling me a genuine moron because I had not realized that inside the dolls there was the jobba. Jobba is a job, I understand.
The jobba, of course, was Lucky's real job, drug trafficking. In fact, Luciano was slowly but surely establishing a vast international heroin racket in affiliation with his mob cohorts back in America.
He somehow cornered the market and then found a way to get the heroin processed in laboratories and factories in central Italy. And then he found a pipeline to get the stuff to New York, and he started making millions and millions of dollars all over again.
By the late 40s, Luciano had become a familiar sight in Italy, hopping from town to town, visiting nightclubs and fancy hotels. He would stroll the elegant Via Veneto in Rome, dine at the sumptuous Hotel de Palme in Palermo, and enjoy the magnificent view from the Hotel Vesuvio in Naples, and the Mafia King never went unnoticed.
He could be a very likable, charming guy, but he also could just terrorize people into doing his bidding. No one would dare oppose him.
He had charisma. Yes, he did. And it didn't come from the watch he had, where the hours were marked by little diamonds, real diamonds, and you could tell that they were real. And it wasn't just the way he dressed, because, surprisingly, he was a true gentleman. He was larger than life. He had the look that could be attributed to a leading actor. To the leading actor, because when he walked in, he attracted attention.
So glamorous a figure that one day, while waving to reporters, he was mistaken for a famous Italian actor. It was his movie star charisma that attracted a stunning Italian woman, some 20 years his junior, named Igea Lissoni.
A very lovely girl. She took to Lucky Luciano. They used to call him Lucky over there, L-O-O-K-Y. Not being able to pronounce the word lucky. And she took to Lucky Luciano in a big way. And I think he really did find the love of his life. And they were very, very happy together.
The couple moved into a lavish apartment in the elegant Patioli quarter of Rome, but they wouldn't be there very long. Since Luciano's deportation, the flow of narcotics from Italy into the United States had skyrocketed. Lucky was the natural suspect. In an effort to catch him, the U.S. Narcotics Bureau joined forces with Italian authorities. In July 1949, Italian police arrested an alleged Luciano associate at the Rome airport with $500,000 in cocaine. Even though there was no direct evidence linking him to the coke, Lucky was confined in Rome's Regina Celli prison for 2 weeks. Then the Romans told the middle-aged gangster he was no longer welcome in the city. Lucky was exiled once again. But a bigger disappointment was in store for Luciano when the mob back in America began to question his role as chairman of the board. Exiled from Rome in 1949, Lucky Luciano, the chairman of the mob, retreated to Naples. Over the next 13 years, Luciano's power within the American mafia would erode to a point where the mob chieftains back in New York would threaten to kill him. Lucky and his mistress, Igea, settled into a luxurious penthouse in Naples on Via Tasso with a breathtaking view of the city. From there, Luciano managed to conduct transatlantic mob business, work for which he was well compensated.
$25,000 in cash every month from the American mob, showing the respect that the American mob still had for him as the boss of all bosses.
But all of Lucky's power and money could not buy him the one thing he wanted most, passage back to America.
He was miserable. He used to say, if they would just give me a week, just give me a week in New York and a week in Miami and I could die happy. But he was never allowed home.
The homesick Luciano seldom passed up a chance to mingle with American tourists.
I'm sitting in Naples with my wife, and Lucky Luciano comes over. He introduced his dog. Dog's name was Bambi. I said, Bambi? After Disney film? He says, yeah, I like fairy tales. I says, what can I do for you, Lucky? He says, I want to hear New York talk. New York talk? Yeah. So we talk New York. I have a New York accent. And he missed it.
The closest thing to home Luciano could find in Naples was the California, an American-style restaurant where the boss could hobnob with tourists and U.S. naval officers.
You'd go in there in the early evening, and there was this mobster autographing the menus of the restaurant, the greatest trophy that a sailor could bring back from a trip to the Mediterranean was a menu of the California autographed by Lucky Luciano.
The former head of Murder, Inc. had mellowed with age. In time, he developed a reputation for generosity, offering to help Neapolitans in need.
In the morning, when I used to come here, I would see 7-8 people waiting for Lucky Luciano outside the restaurant. And these people would say to him, Mr. Lucky, Mr. Luciano, my husband is unemployed. To some, Mr. Luciano gave 30,000 liras, to some 20,000. In some cases, he would pay for a doctor to visit sick people at home. It's incredible how much good this man did.
Luciano took on the appearance of a legitimate businessman. A few yards from the Naples landmark, Castel de Lovo, he opened a hospital supply store. It would help him to distract authorities and camouflage the income he received from his dope operation and his American associates. The mafia lord lived a very comfortable life.
Whenever he could, he would go out to the racetrack, the Agnano racetrack. He used to place big bets on safe horses. Then he would go out to the islands in the bay, Capri and Ischia.
At night, Lucky could be seen with his mistress at the magnificent Teatro San Carlo or at the restaurant Z Teresa on the Santa Lucia waterfront. But Luciano's Dolce Vita didn't last long. In 1958, Igea, his girlfriend of 9 years and the love of his life, died of cancer. It was a devastating loss.
After her death, he didn't want to talk about her anymore because he suffered when he talked about her. The only woman he loved in his life was Igea, in the real sense of love and affection.
After Igea's death, Lucky's life started to unravel. His relationship with the American mob grew strained. The other bosses felt he was grabbing more than his share of the profits from the heroin business. The checks he received from the U.S. syndicate got smaller and smaller. Then in 1959, Lucky and the mob had a rude awakening when Fidel Castro took over from Batista in Cuba. Castro closed the casinos and shut down the heroin pipeline. The mob lost millions. So the aging Luciano, looking for a new scheme, hatched the idea of making a movie about his life with a producer from Spain. The boss was assured that Dean Martin was going to play the lead role since he and Dean had a friend in common, Frank Sinatra.
And then he said, well, maybe I better check it out with the boys back in New York. And so he told them about this idea, and they held a meeting and they say, no, if you make this film, it will make things so terrible for all of us. It would be virtual history of organized crime in America with you as the big shot, that it could conceivably bring the law down on us so heavily. So they told Lucky that if he went ahead and made the film, he would be killed.
Lucky retaliated by threatening to cut off his American associates from their supply of heroin, and he did not give up on his plans to make the film. It was more than the mafia in New York could tolerate. They took out a contract on his life. Tipped off that he was in danger, Lucky secluded himself in his penthouse on Via Tasso. His health was deteriorating, his chest pains returned, and his blood pressure rose. In 1961, Luciano was hospitalized with a heart ailment. On the morning of January 26, 1962, Lucky stopped in at the California to place an order for lunch.
It was around 11 o'clock when he came in and asked for salt cod Sicilian style. And the maître d' said, okay. He said, I'll be back at 1:30. I'm just going to Capo di Chino airport to pick up someone.
And he went up to the airport in Naples to welcome the producer who was flying in to discuss the film project. And then, after he had welcomed him and they went to the parking lot to the car, he was suddenly stricken by a terrible heart attack.
Charles Lucky Luciano died instantly. He was 64. Luciano's funeral was a majestic procession through Naples. Mourners lined the streets. In death, his wish to come home to America had been granted. His body was flown to New York and buried in a Catholic cemetery in Queens. Over the years, there has been speculation that the former king of the underworld was poisoned by the mob.
Some people said he was killed. Some people said that he was poisoned. It's not true at all. The truth is that he died from a heart attack. He really suffered from a weak heart, and we knew it.
Charles Lucky Luciano left a legacy that is still with us today. Organized crime.
If you can apply the word genius to crime, Lucky Luciano was a genius, because to take this disorganized mass of crooks, gamblers, and murderers, thieves and whatnot, and build them into a structured organization was a remarkable achievement.
There's a sense of power this man generated in seducing everybody around him. You looked in his eyes, you wouldn't look too long. It was a little frightening. That was power too, very powerful.
It wasn't that he was more violent than the other guys. It wasn't that he was more dangerous. Luciano was able to control his emotions and preserve equanimity when things got hot. And somehow he inspired confidence in the other guys that he was the one, that he was the leader.
He structured the La Cosa Nostra as it has continued to this very day. You could not have a good understanding of the history of organized crime in the United States without having studied Charles Lucky Luciano.
It was a year after Luciano's death that mob informants began spilling some of the dirtiest secrets of the crime syndicate at Senate hearings. Lucky Luciano helped make the mob what it is today, but it is not the untouchable group it was when he was the boss.